Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Pastor Mike. We're so excited to have you with us today. We're going to start our worship service in just a minute, but I want to let you know we also have a service for our children also. If you go to our website, harvestlifecc.com, click at the tab at the top called Kids Life, and the service will be there. The kids will have a blast. You'll probably even want to join them because it'll be so much fun for them. If you've never been with us before, we're excited to get to know you a little bit. So on our website, you can send us a message, tell us a little bit about yourself, and then also you can search through there and you can see all the things about us also. So we're so glad you're with us today. Let's worship God together.
Praise you, God. Today's the day, Lord, that you have made. And God, we are going to rejoice and we're going to be glad today, this week, God. Hallelujah. We just praise you.
At break of day, we rise, we speak your name, we lift our eyes, tune our hearts to your beat. Where we walk, there you'll be, fire in our eyes, our life's a light, your love untamed, it's blazing out, the streets will glow, forever bright, your glory's breaking through the night, you will never fade away. Here to stay by side.
God. Hallelujah. And Lord, we just thank you right now that everything you've made, everything you've done, God, is for us, Lord.
Hallelujah. From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty.
Yes, hallelujah.
From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by. Lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laid with snow. Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom. Uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God.
Yes, God, so amazing, God.
All powerful, untamable, our strength we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God.
Yes, God.
Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depth of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God.
Yes, Lord. You are amazing. So wonderful. In all of you, God. Hallelujah. We just praise you.
All my hands have made, I'm laying down. All that I hold dear, my many crowns.
Yes, God.
I've tasted and seen of your great love. You satisfy me. Satisfy me, Spirit, fall. Oh.
to invade right now. Right now, hallelujah. Invade our hearts, God. Invade our minds, Father. With your beautiful words, with your beautiful love, God. With who you are, invade us. Hallelujah. Lord, we just thank you. Contaminate our soul. Contaminate our lives, Father, our minds with your word. Hallelujah. We just praise you, Lord.
Oh, Lord, you're beautiful. In your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me.
Hallelujah. Your grace and your mercy, God, your peace. All I need, God.
Oh Lord, you're beautiful, and your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. Your grace abounds to me.
God, hallelujah. Lord, we just want to be a light to you, God. We want to be your light, Father. Lord, we just want to take your word, the light unto our path, Father. Lord, to share it, to take it forth to your nation, God. But Lord, we're not doing it for us, Father. We're not doing it for our emotional benefit, God. We're doing it for you, God. We want to take your word for your benefit, God. Hallelujah, Lord. Jesus, right here for you.
First, help me just to live it, Lord. And when I'm doing well, help me to never seek a crown. For my reward is bringing glory to you.
Hallelujah, God, you are our reward. Your glory, God. Lord, we just praise you. Jesus, for you, God.
Oh Lord, you're beautiful,
and your face is all. You, Father, for everything you've done, for everything, every part of you, everything you stand for, everything that you are, Father. We just thank you.
Praise God. God is so good, isn't he? We just love worshiping God. You guys, I want to take a minute to talk to you about partnering with us here at Harvest Life. If you're new here and not a member, we don't want you to feel obligated into giving into the offering. Our members are such great givers, and we just want you to be our guest and enjoy the service. But if you do want to give, you can go to our website and click on the online giving tab at the top. Again, we're so thankful for those of you that support our ministry and help us in sharing the gospel and sharing the love of God with everyone else. And at this time, I'd also like to remind you, let's not forget about our missionaries. They're on the front lines doing the work. And in spite of the coronavirus and then all the economic confusion and fallout that's happening right now, they're still doing their job and they're out there. So let's remember to also keep supporting them also, because at this time they could probably really use it. So again, I want to encourage you to continue giving into our missions offerings so that we can keep supporting them and not forget them in this time of all this crisis that's going on. So thanks again. We'll be back in a minute with just a message. Well, good morning. We've been doing a series called The Power of Your Thoughts, and we finished that last week. And now I'm starting a new series called The Power of Your Words. The power of your words, because our thoughts eventually turn into our words, and any words that come out of your mouth started as a thought first, right? And so I think that words are it's really important to focus on the words that we say and the power that's behind them. So today I want to talk to you about the fact that our words have power. They have power in our life. We use them every day. Words like, I love you. You're important to me. Thank you so much. May I help you? You look nice today. How can I ever repay you? I like your haircut. Great job. Will you marry me? I've missed you so much. I love you, Grandma. We're having a baby. See, all of those are words that come out of our mouth, and each one of those has an emotion attached to them. They have an emotion attached to them, and they cause an emotion in the other people that we're talking to, of course, too. Every one of those words are important words in our life. But here's some more words that are in our life also. I hate you. You disgust me. I wish I'd never been born. You make me sick. Nobody cares about you. Nobody cares about me. What an idiot. I'll never speak to you again. I want a divorce. I want to kill myself. All of those are words too. And they come from deep emotions also. And they create a deep emotion inside the people we're speaking to when we speak those words also. That's why I want to talk to you about again today, the power of our words, because words are powerful. Words create a lot of times the world we live in. They shape our world by our words. They reveal the faith that we have in life sometimes too. Our words really reveal what's on the inside of us, okay? So as we look at the subject of our words, we need to understand one important fact. We as humans are made up of three parts, okay? Body, soul, and spirit. We're made up of three parts. And just everything affects us in all three of those areas. Our words affect us in every one of those areas. It affects our environment. Our words can affect our body, our soul, and our mind, and our spirit also. They can affect our physical environment. They can affect the souls of other people. They can also affect the spirit of another person too by speaking those words to them. So words are powerful, they really are. And here's the thing, once a word is spoken, it really can't be taken back. It's done. It's done. Now you can change the way you speak, and you can change the outcome of those words. You can, or you can start to repair the words that you spoke, you know, repair the situation. But those words can't really be undone. They cut to the heart. Oftentimes words will hurt a person worse than actions will. And I'm sure you guys have heard that before. You can't really take them back, because words have an immediate effect on people. When you speak them, immediately those words cause an effect on that other person. That's why Jesus said this in 5:37. He said this, "But let your yes be yes, and your no be no. For whatever is more than these is from the evil one." And what he's saying, paraphrasing, what he's really saying is that keep your speech short. Say yes or no. He says anything else that you communicate can be twisted. It can be misunderstood. It can be misquoted. So, and we can see that all the time today. And in today's world we're living in right now, with so much confusion with the coronavirus and all the other things that are going on in life, it's real easy for our words to get twisted or misinterpreted. So again, we have to be really careful for the words that we speak. Real careful for the words that we speak. I remember a saying once that I heard, and I've quoted it probably several times in other sermons too, but I really think it's an important saying. It says this, it says, "Watch your thoughts, for they become words." And again, we just finished a series on thoughts. "Watch your words, for they become actions. Watch your actions, for they become habits. Watch your habits, for they become your character. And watch your character, because it will shape your destiny." And that's so true. It's so true. So we have to be really careful the words we speak, because ultimately they will shape our destiny. They will. And so it's important to be careful that we say words that are encouraging and not destructive. Okay? Words of affirmation are far more important than words of criticism, right? So again, there's a saying I think that was really good. Martin Luther King Jr. said this, "In the end, we will remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends." So not only is it important to watch the words that we speak, it's also important that we speak the words that need to be spoken, you know, at times when they need to be spoken. So it's really careful. We have to be really careful to examine what we say. In the last series, I said this several times. I said, you have to think about what you think about, right? Well, I'd have to add to that today. You have to think about what you say. You have to think about what you say. If you think about what you think about first and really think about it carefully, and then shape your words to match what you know you really need to say and how to say it, then hopefully the communication will come out not misinterpreted and misunderstood. Okay? Here's another saying. It says this, "It's better to be silent and be thought a fool than to speak and remove all doubt." So just as it's important to speak when you need to speak, it's oftentimes even more important to just be quiet. Just be quiet. Don't say anything. Don't say anything. Here's another saying, "Be sure your words are always sweet. You may have to eat them." And I know I've said things in my life that I had to go back and eat, and the taste wasn't very good. And I'm sure you've all experienced that in your life at one time or another too. Again, all these quotations have to do with interactions between people. Interactions between people. The effect that they have on people. Do our words have influence in other areas? Sure they do. Is there a power to our words that we don't pay enough attention to? Let's examine that today, and that's what I want to look at. Let's look how God operates first, okay? Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. "Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image, and in the image of God he created him. Male and female, he created them. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." You'll notice in Genesis before that, he talked about where he said, "Let there be light," and there was. And he spoke several things, and when he did, those things came into existence, okay? But I want you to notice something in the passage I just read also. First of all, it says he made man in his image. He made man in his image. The word image there means a pattern, a model, if you will, similar. Okay, it comes from the word dama, which means to be like, resemble, or to act like. To act like. Did you know that you're supposed to act like God? Absolutely. You're supposed to act like God. You're not God, but you're supposed to act like you're one of his children. Okay, because you've been made in his image. You've been made to imitate God and to operate like God operates and to speak and see things happen, okay, just like God does. The second thing I notice about that scripture is that God gave man the authority to rule over his environment. He gave man the authority to rule over his environment. Number three, he blessed them and told them to fill the earth and subdue it. This means to take control by force. It means that we're in a battle, if you will, and we're commanded to win. We're commanded to win that battle. So how do we do this? How does God do it? He's our model. That's the best way. So we have to model what God does in our life so that we can act like his children and get the results that God wants us to have in our life, okay? Let's look at Isaiah 55, verse 11. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. Now that's God speaking. So what he's saying here is that the words that go out of his mouth, they will not return to him void or unproductive. Unproductive. They're going to produce something, God says, okay? And it'll accomplish what he says and what he pleases, and it'll prosper, see? And so several things you can get from this. Number one, the word was sent. The word was sent like a messenger, if you will. It was sent out. The word was sent out, and it comes out of God's mouth. He didn't just think it, see? He spoke it out of his mouth, okay? Number three, another third thing I saw about that is it does not fail. When God speaks something, it will not fail. If God's spoken things to you in your life, it will not fail. The promises in the Word of God that he's spoken towards you will not fail. The words that God has spoken to your heart will not fail. They will not. They will return to him, not void, but fulfilling what God's purposed them to fulfill. Okay, it will be successful. And another thing, it came from the heart of God. It says that it's what pleased him. It's what pleased him. So the words that come out of his mouth came straight from the heart of God. And then the other thing I saw in that is the words that God's spoken, they return to him. They return to him. In other words, the success brings confirmation of what God has spoken, right? Well, here's the thing. Don't we see in our life a lot of times our words return to us? Sometimes not very good though, right? Those are the words that we have to end up eating. They came back to us, see? I'd have to say, honestly, most of the words that you speak are going to come back to you, either good or bad. If you speak something good to someone, something good is going to be spoken back to you at some point in time. If you speak something bad, it does come back to you. It really does, okay? And so, here we go. Chronologically, from what that scripture is telling us there, okay, is something was in the heart of God in the form of a desire, okay? So something was in the heart of God as in the form of a desire. He decided to send it out like a mission, if you will. His words were sent out, okay? And when he sent it out, he spoke it. He spoke the word, okay? And those words begin to have an effect on whatever God was focusing them on. Are you getting this? They had an effect on whatever God was focusing them on. They work until they're successful. Those words keep working until they're successful. Then the completion of those words becomes evident as a fact. Okay, they return to him. I want to say that again. When God speaks a word, this is what happens. First of all, it starts in the heart of God as a form of a desire. In the form of a desire. Then he decides to send it out, like in a mission, if you will. And when he sent it out, he spoke it. That's how he sent it out. Then those words begin to have an effect on that environment, that situation, whatever God was focusing them on, okay? And they work until they're successful, and then the completion of those words becomes evident as a fact. God said, let there be light. Those words went out, light became, okay? And so God speaks things into existence. Let's show you another scripture here. Romans chapter 10, verse 6. But the righteousness of faith speaks in this way. Do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who will descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you and in your mouth and in your heart, that is the word of faith which we preach. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So here's what I want you to see. Even in your salvation, first it started in your heart. You believed, and then you spoke something out of your mouth, and it went forth and it accomplished what? Your salvation. See? And what he's saying in verse 6, he says, righteousness of faith speaks this way. Do not say in your heart, right? But then it says, what does it say? Down further it says, in verse 8, it says, the word is near you, even in your mouth and in your heart. See? So what it's saying there is that when you're operating in faith, you have to speak words out of your mouth. Okay, out of your mouth. So it's saying when you need something in this earth now, we don't say, hey God, would you please come and do this? What we have to do is we have to speak words of faith out of our mouth and then watch those words go forth just like out of God's mouth and see things happen. Of course, those words have to be in line with the word of God. Okay, we're not talking about just whatever you want to do. I understand that. I hope you do too, right? But what I'm saying is that when the promises of God are evident to us, it begins to build faith on the inside of us. And then as we speak those words forth, it begins to change the situation. It changes the environment we're in, just as if God has spoken them. Because again, those words that come out of our mouth are guided by the Holy Spirit, prompted by the word of God. So again, let's look at another verse. Mark chapter 11, verse 22 and 23. So Jesus answered him and said to them, have faith in God. Have faith in God. And in the Greek, what it really says is to have the faith of God. Have the faith of God. So in other words, have the same kind of faith that God has. The same kind of faith that God has. Use your faith the same way God uses his. I want to say that again. Use your faith the same way that God uses his, okay? And how does he use his faith? He speaks it out of his mouth. He speaks it out of his mouth, filled with faith and knowing that when it goes forth, it's going to keep working until it accomplishes what was in his heart's desire at the beginning. Verse 23, for assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will come to pass, he will have whatever he says. See? And that's pretty amazing, isn't it? If you say to that mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and don't doubt in your heart, that would actually happen, right? So I got to tell you a funny story that happened to me when I was just a brand new Christian. So I read this scripture here, and I thought, literally, okay, if that's what it says, I'm going to do it. I'm going to try and see if it works. So I went outside. Don't laugh at me. I went outside, and I looked up at Mount Rainier. And I said, Mount Rainier, and I spoke in a deeper voice because it's more powerful that way, right? And I spoke in King James English, too, because there's more power in the King James English if you speak the these and thous, you know, it's more spiritual. So I said, Mount Rainier, be thou cast into the sea. And I stood and I watched, waiting for the mountain to be cast into the sea. And it didn't move. I thought I saw some rocks tumble down. So, you know, I'm thinking maybe I got a little tremble out of it, maybe, but it didn't go into the sea, right? And then I got thinking later, I wonder why that didn't work, right? Well, maybe it wasn't prompted by God. Maybe it wasn't really in line with the word of God. So maybe what he was saying there wasn't really talking about a literal mountain. Although I suppose that if you were in a situation where you needed something like that to get out of the way for some reason, maybe that would work for you, okay? But when it's talking about there are situations in your life, see, a lot of times when we're faced with something in our life, that seems like a mountain to us. It seems like an insurmountable task ahead of us or something that's overwhelming us. And if God is saying, stand up, stand on the word of God, stand in faith and speak to that thing. Speak to that thing and see in your mind. Remember I've talked before about your imagination? You need to have a great imagination. You really do. But you have to be in control of your imagination also, because here's the thing. You have an imagination. If you worry, you're using your imagination. If you have doubt, you're using your imagination. If you have fear, you're using your imagination, but in the negative way. And what I'm saying is if you can sit there and play little movies in your mind about horrible things that might happen to you or worrying about this or that, then you can click the channel changer of your mind, if you will, to something positive and begin to think positive things, okay? So if there's a mountain in front of you that seemed insurmountable, begin to see that thing move. Begin to see that situation work out. Begin to see your marriage begin to work instead of fail. Begin to see those children, serving God, and begin to see that loved one or yourself healed and whole. You know, so what we do is we get into the Word of God and we see the promises that are there, and they bring hope into our life. And well, the scripture says that what happens is that faith will take hold of that hope and turn it into something that you can see in front of you, something that's substance. Well, what does that mean? That means the words that you speak out of your mouth in line with the word of God, they're going to go forth and they're going to accomplish what you purposed in your heart, the hope that's in your heart, to see that thing come to pass. See? And that's what your faith does. It brings that thing into substance for you, see? The situation begins to work out, okay? So again, we have to use our faith the same way God uses his faith, see? And Paul said it this way, 2 Corinthians 4:13, he says, "And since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I have believed and therefore I spoke." See, Paul said, "I have believed and therefore I spoke." And we also believe and therefore speak. See? And so, first of all, again, this isn't going to happen if you just go around saying, "Well, I'm just going to say this, and see and expect all that stuff to happen." It doesn't work that way. What I'm saying is you have to begin to get into the Word of God. You have to begin to get to know God. I know I've mentioned this before, but maybe you haven't watched those series, those sermons. But, you know, faith really is a very simple thing. Faith can grow. It's just like trust, okay? You don't trust someone you don't know. You don't trust someone you don't know. So how do you get to trust somebody? You get to know them. You build trust in them. They build a track record with you, see? And after a while, you can trust them, right? Well, it's the same thing. You have to get to know God and understand the promises that are in his word that he has for you, and pretty soon faith rises, and now you can speak something. If you didn't do that, then you're just rattling off things that you want, or you know, you think that are going to happen in your life, and they don't happen. You think, well, that didn't work. I said those things, and it didn't work. Well, it didn't work because you didn't have faith. You have to have faith first. And faith is not some magical thing. You already have faith in your life. You do. If you trust anyone in your life, you have faith. You have faith in them. See? Well, the faith in them works the same way with God. You can't have faith in God if you don't know him. And the only way to get to know God is to get into his word and read about him. Read about him and talk to him and pray and let him speak to your heart also. And pretty soon trust, faith will begin to rise up on the inside of you. And pretty soon when you do speak those words, it comes to pass. Why? Because the faith in you is creating that thing into substance for you. Okay? So anyway, again, I hope you understand that we're in Christ and God and the Holy Spirit's on the inside of us, leading us, teaching us, guiding us, so that we can walk as children of God and walk and have the power to change things in our life. Because you were designed, like I talked about in Genesis there, we were supposed to subdue this earth. We're supposed to take control. And God wants you to be in control of your environment, not your environment dictating to you. See? Whatever is happening in your life, you have the power and the authority to overcome that thing. But you're going to have to take it by the horns. You're going to have to get into the Word of God, see? Because the Bible says you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Amen? But again, that doesn't mean you just get to sit around and do nothing. You have to get into the Word of God and begin to learn and grow and then apply it. Because faith without works is dead. So at some point in time, not only are you going to have to grow in your faith, but your faith is going to have to align with your actions. I should say it this way. Your actions are going to have to align with your faith. Because here's the thing. Already your actions are aligning with your faith. They really are. See? And that's why you're in wherever situation you're in right now. But if you can change your faith and then take those, look at your faith that you have that's growing in God and say, okay, well, if God promises and I believe it, then I need to act on it. And when you act on it, the Bible says faith without works is dead. Well, that means that if you do act on it with works, you know, if you act on your faith, it brings life to that faith. It energizes it. See? It energizes it. So I really encourage you to get into the Word of God. Look at the words that you speak. Look at the thoughts that you think, okay? think about the words that you speak to your spouse. Think about the words that you speak to your children. They have a power to accomplish what you say. They really do, okay? And that's why it makes it so important. So how do we start saying the right things? How do we start, you know, thinking the right things? Philippians 4:8 says this, "Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. That's so important. Again, it goes back to, what's he focusing on? Thinking. What are you thinking about? See? Think about what you think about, because your words are really a reflection of what's on the inside of you and what you're thinking. So if the words that are coming out of you are words that you know aren't right, and they're words that are coming out of you, words that you know you're going to have to eat later, then what you can really say is, you know, my thoughts are wrong. My thoughts are wrong. Because if the wrong words are coming out, again, they're a reflection of what's on the inside in your thoughts. So wrong words, okay, I got some wrong thoughts in there I need to change. And the best way to change the thoughts, again, get into the Word of God. You know, I just really believe that not enough people read their Bible every day. They need to be in the Word of God, because if the time comes when you need something in your life, it's probably gonna be based on how much of the Word of God you have on the inside of you. It really is. And so I really encourage you, I can't say it enough, I know I sound like a broken record sometimes, but you've got to read the Word of God. You've got to get to know God and have a personal relationship with Him. It's not good enough to just be saved. You can be saved and go to heaven and have a rotten life here on earth. You really can. You can have a horrible life here on earth and be saved and go to heaven. But God wants you to have a life filled here with joy and fulfillment. Jesus said, I come to give life and life more abundantly. He wants you to have life now, here, joyful, fulfilled, overcoming life, filled with the purposes and the plans of God for your life. Because God said He has a plan for you. Your days are all mapped out, full of wonderful things, He says. He'll show you things that you don't even know of, things you couldn't even dream of. But again, we have to pursue Him. We have to, and God's promise that He says, you'll find me if you pursue me with all your heart. So I really encourage you to pursue God, because what'll happen is it'll change you on the inside, and the words that come out of your mouth will be filled with power and with authority and with love and purpose, and it'll change your environment. And not only your environment, but the environment of the people around you. Life can be wonderful and filled with joy and peace, but we shape the world we live in quite often by the words that come out of our mouth. So I hope this is helping somebody. I have another scripture I want to read to you. Psalm 19, verse 14. The psalmist is saying this. He says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, and what I'm thinking, right, be acceptable in your sight, O God, my strength and my redeemer. So again, as we think about the things we think about and the words that we speak, are they acceptable to God? Is God happy with our thought life? Happy with the things that we think about? See? And again, I want to read this, another quote to you that I think is really important. Whatever you hold in your mind will tend to occur in your life. If you continue to believe as you've always believed, you will continue to act as you've always acted. If you continue to act as you've always acted, you will continue to get what you've always gotten. If you want different results in your life or your work, all you have to do is change your mind. And your mind will change your words and create a new destiny instead of the one that you've been working on so long. So I hope this is an encouragement to you. We're going to continue with words, the power of our words, for the next couple weeks. And I hope this will help you. Again, your thoughts are going to shape your words, and your words are going to change. I believe good things for you and for your family. I really do. And it's going to be because of changes taking place inside of you and inside of me. So I hope this helps everybody today. Thank you again. And also I want to just say, you know, that if this service was an encouragement to you and you found insight in God's love, could you go to our website and send us a message? Let us know that this is a help to you. Let us know that these messages are helping you in some way. So I really encourage you to stay connected. I mentioned that our website has services for our children. There's also, on every Friday night, we also host a Bedtime Stories with the Skit Guys. It's a program that shares a bedtime story for our kids, and it's a little, they show different things there, and a little, they teach a biblical principle for our children, and the kids will really have a good time with that also. And then every once in a while, also online, I'm hosting, you'll see it on Facebook and our website and then also on YouTube, Coffee with Pastor Mike. It's a time where I get together and have a cup of coffee with you, and I share something from the Word of God, hopefully an encouragement. Sometimes it's on current events, and other times it's just a series that I'm teaching. So, and we also have a Facebook page, if you will. I want to remind you of this too. We have a Bible reading journey that we do where we're reading through the Bible together, and then we read a couple different chapters, and then we make comments and share what your thoughts are on that scripture, on that chapter, because we can learn from one another, because you'll see something in the Word of God that I don't see, and maybe I'll see something in the Word of God that you don't see also. So it's a great way for us to learn together and from each other. And again, also, one other thing also I want to mention to you, if you're interested in becoming a member of Harvest Life, you can also mention that on our website in a message to us, and we'll get you information about the church on how to become a member. Because just because you haven't been in the physical location yet, you can still become a member of Harvest Life and be a part of our family. We thank you so much again for joining us today. I hope this is a blessing to you. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I just want to pray for you a minute. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you so much for all the people that are listening to this sermon. I pray that it helps every person. I pray that we begin to see all the wonderful things that you have in your word. I pray that we begin to see the love that you have that's filled in every one of those words. I pray that every person here would understand who they are in God, and that they're God's child, loved by God, commissioned by God to be one of his children. And I pray that every person that is hearing this prayer, I pray, Lord, for peace in their family and joy in their life. And I pray for safety in the name of Jesus. I pray, Lord, that their life be filled with joy and have a fulfillment in their life. I pray that you help them to understand the plan that you have for their life, plans of goodness and not of evil, of an expected end. You have an expected end of their life, for their life, or in other words, a plan for their life of goodness and wonderful things. So I just pray peace and joy in the lives of every person listening to this prayer. Again, I thank you, Lord, that they all be safe in the middle of all this economic situation that's going on with the coronavirus and all the upheaval that's happening in the world right now with the different racism events that are going on right now, the protesting. I just pray for safety for everybody in that. And I pray most of all that peace would rule and reign, and that justice would rule and reign, and that your love and your righteousness would rule and reign. And Jesus, you said that you would keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon you. I pray that every person get their mind on Jesus, because Jesus, you are the answer to every one of our problems and our issues in life. So I just pray, Lord, that more and more we're able to share your love and your grace and your mercy to this world, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. My spirit.